Thank you. So thank you for the invitation. My talk is in the direction of mathematical economics and not so much into this setting of mathematical finances. I didn't think about any application or whatever to mathematical finances. And who knows, maybe there is, but I don't know. So any suggestion is welcome. So this is a work done with a student of mine, Renato Soeiro. And we looked to the usual Bertrand dual poly framework, but in a quite different way from the usual one. So we have a two stages game, as in the Bertrand framework. In the first stage, we have two firms that have to decide about which price they should practice. Here, the examples that we have in mind are like hotels, resources, resorts, computers, like selling computers, bars, places where the environment, the people that goes to those places to buy, it counts, or the people that use a certain kind of computer, it counts for the choice that we are going to make of the computer. Like if all my friends work with a Macintosh, then I want to buy a Macintosh. If no one of my friends does not use a Macintosh, then I might not want to buy a Macintosh. So who is making decision with us, it's important for us. So that's the framework that we have in mind. And so in the second stage, we have consumers. Here it's a finite set of consumers, and as usual, they observe the prices, and taking into account the prices that they will observe, they will choose which strategy they will have. So here we'll discuss a lot mixed strategies. So the individuals will decide in probability either to go to one hotel or to go to the other hotel. Like when you make your decisions for your holidays, sometimes you want to go to the mountain, other times you prefer to go to the beach. So we'll have these consumers or individuals playing some mixed strategy, and then you'll have another group of consumers that they will be loyal. They will always go to the beach, or they will always go to the mountain. So we have these two types of individuals. The loyals, that are those ones that they really prefer to go to the mountain every year, and the other ones, the ones that they will prefer to use a mixed strategy to go sometimes to the mountain, other times to go to the beach. So during the whole talk for consumers, I will be always using the Nash equilibrium. So for this second stage game, I will always be considering that is the Nash equilibrium of the game. So by that, I mean that after the individuals make their decision, no one has an incentive to change his decision because he'll do worse or will not do better. So it is a Nash equilibrium. In fact, when we have mixed strategies, these Nash equilibriums are kind of weak. And by weak, it means that after we have the Nash equilibrium, they will not change to another equilibrium because they will not do better. But they will also not do worse, in fact. So these mixed equilibriums are really in the border between stable and unstable equilibrium. For the ones that are loyals, for the individuals that will play a lawyer, they will always go to the mountain or they will always go to the beach. For those ones, the equilibrium is quite stable. So if we, by this I mean that if we change slightly the parameters of the game, they will keep going to the mountain or they will keep going to the beach. So the loyal players, the players that will play a pure probability, they will not really want to change their mind in a small neighborhood of parameters. Those ones, because of that, we'll consider them that they are fixed. And so we'll concentrate our analysis only in the mixed strategies because these are the players that are sensitive to the parameters of the game. For the first stage, since all the study is all local, as you are going to see, I will always be discussing local optimums, local strategic optimums. And I will not be discussing never Nash equilibrium because for that I needed to put some global conditions in my utility functions that I'm not doing. So that's the reason is local for the firms, but always global for the consumers, the Nash equilibrium. And the reason that it's global for the consumers is because the local equilibrium is also global equilibrium. So to discuss local or global is the same. And that is not true for the first stage gain. Okay. So that's what I already explained in the other transparency, but we'll get some notation here. So sigma is the Nash equilibrium of consumer subgame, and P is local pure prices for the two firms. So P is a vector, P1 for the price of firm 1, P2 the price of firm 2, and sigma is the mixed strategy of consumers. So sigma I is the probability that the consumer will go to the hotel, the first hotel, or the first resort, or to buy a Macintosh. And sigma 2 is probability that the consumer will not buy a Macintosh. So this sigma has to do with the mixed strategies in the game. Here it can be mixed or pure. Pure means that sigma is either 1 or 0. And this N is for all the consumers. So sigma for the strategy of consumers, P for the strategy of prices. And the profit is the simplest possible. So the profit of the function of the firm is the price that firm will practice times the demand. And the demand is very simple to compute. It's just to add up the probabilities that the individuals will choose that firm. So that's the demand of firm 1, similarly for firm 2. And now what I'm going to describe to you is consumer's utility that we are going to use, and that's the part, the original part of the model. So it's this discussion of the utility. So we are coming back to utilities in my discussion. Okay. So let me already show everything to you. So the utilities that we are going to have, this one is for the utility of the consumers. If they are going to shop the product 1 or to firm 1, or if they go to the hotel in the beach, the utility U2, this 2 is for the ones that go to the mountain or don't buy the Macintosh. That's the utility when they buy another product. These utilities have three terms. And so the first one is the price difference, and that's like the Bertrand model. So in the Bertrand model, the utility is minus the price and minus price. So the minus the price of product 2, and here minus the price of product 1. The usual standard product differentiation is given by these B's. So P for the prices, B for the standard product differentiation. And this B is how much they value the good. So B1 is how much they like to go to the beach. B2 is how much they like to the mountain. That's how much they like the product. That's the B, the valuation of the product. And then the third part, that's like what we decided to introduce in this model. We don't see it much in mathematical economics, in fact, so like it's our contribution to the area. I'm not saying that it doesn't exist, of course it exists in the area, but our contribution is really to study this utility. And this is the part that we find extremely interesting in this model. So what is this alpha I? So this is where you see you look to the strategies of all the other players, and depending of their strategy, like depending if they go to the beach or if they go to the mountain or if they go to one bar or to another bar or if they buy the Macintosh or they buy another product, that will have a utility for them. So the decisions of the other players, they really matter in their utility. We look to the profile of strategies of the individuals, and now we let them have an influence in their utility. One example is the case of networks. And there's a huge literature in networks. And so in the case of that we have networks, we can think that as an example. And in fact, usually like the simplest example, like the linear case, where these alphas are linear functions. So that's our context. And so our interest is to see how these functions, so this social product differentiation that we introduce in the model, to see what are the conclusions that we can get from that. And in fact, it's a kind of quite rich model. And like in mathematical finances, this is quite extremely clear. Like the decisions of the others, they really affect you. If people decide to sell all their shares, it really is affecting the other individual. So in this context, like this model, this kind of utility is really important. Okay. So as I have already explained, so the valuation type, and that's how much the individuals like to make a decision. And what is usually called externality type and crowding type of the individuals is all located in this function alpha I. So how she sees the others, that's like when the individual looks to the strategy of the others and see how much that has an influence in his utility and so in his strategy. So that's the crowding type. So the crowding type is she looks to the other individuals, she looks to the other ones, and from what the individual is able to recognize in the other one's strategy, it has an influence in the individual utility. And so it will have a decision in the influence in the final decision of the individuals. So now that I've discussed utility functions, let me introduce communities, because here it makes the full sense to introduce this notion. So instead of looking to each individual on its own, we look to communities without changing the first model. So everything that I'm going to say for communities is, of course, true in the original model. This is not any kind of simplification or whatever. So it's just that something that we can do because the results keep holding in this context. So what is a community? So a community, you can think that it's a set of individuals that you can have an agent, a representative agent for that community. So instead of having to look to all the individuals of the community, you can look only to one representative agent without losing any information. So here, by using a representative agent, we are not simplifying the model because we keep all the information. So this representative agent or community is a set of individuals that they are indistinguishable. So it's a set of individuals that they have the same utility function, and more than having the same utility function, they will decide to use the same strategy. And this is not an assumption, so don't take this as an assumption, because everything that I'm saying keeps to be true in the original model where we look individual by individual. It's an equivalence, like it's a theorem that it's an equivalence. So it's not an assumption, it's a result of the construction. It's just a simplification. Using the communities, we don't lose anything, and we reduce like the number of strategies that we have to look at. So individuals that are the same and they will play the same strategy, we can put them together in a community, and so just to look to one of its representative agents. So the M tells us the number of individuals in each community, and Q tells us the strategy that they're playing. So Q is a number between 0 and 1. It's a probability of choosing to go to the beach or to go to the mountain. And as I told you before, we'll look to do two different kind of players, the ones that we call the loyal communities. Those ones are the ones that will play a pure strategy. So either they'll go to the beach or to the mountain in Nash equilibrio. Again, it's not an assumption, it will be a consequence of the model. We'll prove that at Nash equilibrio, the loyal communities are the ones that at Nash equilibrio, they prefer to play a pure strategy. And the non-loyal communities are the ones that they will play a mixed strategy at Nash equilibrio. So these are not assumptions, are only definitions that we'll use to prove our results. And the demand for firm one consists in L1 that are the loyals, L4 loyals, and Q is the expected value from the probabilities from the individuals that play a mixed strategy. So QJ is the probability of their strategy, and MJ is the number of individuals that will play this mixed strategy. So D keeps being the demand, and this case is adding the loyals to the mixed strategy players. So for the analysis, it will fix the loyal characterization, so we'll fix the L1 and L2. So these are the number of individuals that are choosing to be in a pure strategy, and the other ones will be playing a mixed strategy. So now I have to show you two formulas that will be essential for what I will do next, and these formulas are very simple. So given your utility function, you just take the derivative of the utility with respect to strategy, and we call this Aij, so it's the just first derivative. And so this gives us a matrix that depends on M and on Q. So it depends on the strategy of the individuals. Given the strategy of individuals, we have this matrix that are only the first derivatives. And now from that matrix, we construct this K, and this K, that's like the key of all the model. So this K is the determinant of the matrix that we have constructed, so it's a simple computation, and these Cij's, they denote the ij cofactors of the matrix A. And so this is a number, this K, that depends on the strategy. So just for you to have an idea why we introduced communities, so here is just a network where you look to every individual, but these individuals are in fact aggregated in four communities. So for computing that value of K and the corresponding demands, instead of using this network, if we have communities, that network reduces to a very simple network, and so this computation is much simpler to find the K and the Ds. That's the reason we use communities. But the results are exactly the same. It doesn't change anything. It's just a simplification in model without changing any of the results. And so that's the first result. I only have two results to show you, this one and next one, and then I'll show you just an example. So by a sort of a simple computation, if we have that a price and the strategy that are a candidate to be a local perfect equilibrium, so a solution for the strategic optimum for the first stage and for second stage, we find out that they have to set, we find out this equality. So the change of the demand with the price is given by minus 1 over k. That's the reason we construct that k, because that k tells us the marginal derivative of demand with respect to price. So the first assumption that we get is that we need this number to be negative. Because if this number is positive, then for a given price, if the firm increases the price, it will increase the demand, so it's not at equilibrium. So if this is positive, it will be always good for the firm to increase the price, because when it increases the price, it increases the demand, and so it's not a local optimum. So that comes immediately from the analysis of this equality. And this phi is the path out of equilibrium. So if we are at a local equilibrium and one of the firms decides to deviate, so to change its price, then the individuals will change their strategy, and by changing their strategy, they will keep in this continuation path given by phi that it's unique in the model. So again, it's a result. And so this uniqueness makes it easier for firms to be able to compute this equality. If we don't ask uniqueness, then everything can happen. So this is either we assume that it's continuous and then we have this equality, or we assume that the individuals don't have to play a continuous strategy. They will can do whatever they want, and in that case, we cannot say anything. So, okay, let me pass it to the theorem. The theorem is very simple, but I find it very interesting. And the theorem is written in the other way around. So first I'm going to read the theorem, and then I will make the interpretation of the theorem. So the theorem goes like that. If you choose a strategy for the individuals, so if you say, well, I want my individuals to follow this strategy. So given the strategy that I don't know if it's a perfect equilibrium or not, so given the strategy, we can tell you the prices and the Bs in your model for that strategy to be a local perfect equilibrium. And that's what the result says. So you give me the strategies for the individuals, and for the strategies that you give me, I compute the K that I explained before. Here I compute the corresponding demands, because knowing the strategy of the individuals, I know the demands for firm 1 and for firm 2. And now that I have the demands and the K, then the prices are uniquely given. So this is uniquely determined. We have the prices that the firms have to practice. So there's a unique solution for the prices. As well, when we know the prices, and so by knowing the strategy, we can compute the social preferences of the individuals. We already have the K. Here is the difference of the demands, and this will determine uniquely the Bs for the game. So given strategies, given the strategies, they are a perfect equilibrium if the prices are these ones and if the differences of Bs are these ones. So the way that we would like to read the result would be in the other way around. So here you have always uniqueness. If I read it in the other way around, I don't have uniqueness. So what is to read it in the other way around? To read it in the other way around is, let's start with the Bs. So given the Bs, you have to invert this function. And by inverting this function, you find the strategies. This function determines strategies. But you have to be able to invert it. So it might, and here, as this is a function from strategies to the Bs, from the Bs to the strategies, it's the inverse function, and so the inverse function can be whatever you want, because you can choose your alphas. Since you have all the freedom to choose this function, the inverse can be as good or as bad as you want. And what I mean by as good or as bad, by fixing the Bs, I can choose alpha such that the strategies that I want to be in Nash equilibrium, they are Nash equilibrium for that alpha that I have chosen. So I can have a lot of Qs. So for given Bs, I can have a lot of strategies, the ones that I want, that are solution of this equality, because I just choose alpha such that happens. And then for these Qs, I can also go here, and now I can choose the case, the derivatives of these functions of I, such that the prices that I want are also satisfied. So these are the nonlinearities that you talk a lot in mathematical finances about nonlinearities. So if you give me freedom for me to choose the alphas as nonlinear as I want, I can, for any Bs, to get the strategies that I want, the solutions of this equality. And then by playing with the derivatives of these alpha I's, I can choose these Ks, the ones that I want, and I can realize the prices that I want. So this in mathematical economics is seen sometimes as the negative results, because by choosing the alphas, I can get whatever I want. Now let me talk on the other case. So if you decide that your alphas are linear functions, then all this freedom goes away. So if you are in the linear case, so if your alphas are linear, and that's the usual case in kind of networks, then we prove that this function is invertible. And so for given the bees, they will determine a unique queue, so a unique strategy for the consumers, and a unique price. And that's the result that we have. And when we have this result, I'm fixing the loyals, and just to show you what the loyals can do to make this problem complex. Let me just show you, and that's the last slide. So this is the simplest case. So the simplest case where all the individuals are the same. And here we represent the perfect equilibrium. So in the horizontal line, you are changing the difference of the prices between the firms. And these lines that you see here are the corresponding demands. So for a given price, you'll have a given demand. And then you can see a lot of different lines, ones on top of the others. So for a given difference of prices, you'll have several local perfect equilibriums that you can have in the linear case. So now I'm in the simplest case in linear case. Just by changing the loyals, you don't have uniqueness. You have a lot of possibilities of perfect equilibrium. And when you choose the loyals, then you are choosing in which line you are moving, and that's when you get uniqueness. So the uniqueness is given loyals. When you allow to change your loyals, you lose the uniqueness of the solution. And that's it. So thank you for your attention.